well, Ryan's been singing in preschool with Carter Creek, and he came to us this weekend and said he wanted to sing Jesus Loves Me for the church, and we said, well, sure you can, buddy. So, you ready? So we've been practicing, and he's ready.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes. Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so.
To the Father, I fall in. I'm glad I'm not the only one that has to run to the Father again and again and again and again. I'm glad that His mercies are new every morning, every morning. I'm glad that He has promised us in His Word that He would never leave us or forsake us, that He'd always be there. Sometimes in our flesh, it's a little hard to see that, to see that He's there when we feel all alone, but He's always there. Amen. I'm glad today that of all the songs that we sang, they're just wonderful. I'm glad that I'm reminded every day of my life, I remember where He brought me from and where I am today. I'm glad of that. I'm glad that the name Jesus, the angel said His name would be Jesus because He would save His people from their sin. And Jesus is Yahweh is salvation, is what the name means. The God of glory is salvation. We studied in Sunday school today, and I want to repeat myself and others. If you're not in Sunday school, you're missing out. We studied in Sunday school, and there was so much to together from the lesson today. But I thought, as Brother Shannon, we read from chapter 1 of Matthew, the genealogy of Christ. It's also found in Luke's gospel, and they're completely different. Luke starts at the end, it goes back to Adam, and Matthew starts at Abraham and comes to Mary and the birth of Jesus. And it's great that there is a genealogy there, and we glean from it and learn from it. And we talked about Ruth being a part of the genealogy of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. But this was on his mother's side. On his father's side, there is no genealogy. He has no beginning of days or beginning of life or end of days. Psalms 90:2 says, from everlasting to everlasting, He is Lord. Now, I can't wrap my mind around that. I know it's true, but can anyone think and look back to eternity past? And you say, well, where did it begin? There was no beginning. He is the beginning of all things. He is the omnipotent. He is all-knowing. He is all-powerful. He has existed from everlasting to everlasting. And that's why we are in this building today. We're not here just to hear the good singing. We're not here to hear preaching, just to hear preaching. We're here to worship the one that died for sin and rose again the third day. That's why we're here. We're not here to be political, and even though it's going to get real political before it's over. Not the message, but life. Life. And you say, well, Brother Gary, do you preach politics? You can't preach the Bible without preaching politics. You can't do it. Yeah, I remember sitting in a waiting room at the high. I remember a lot of waiting rooms over the past 45 years. But I remember sitting there one day with a family, and this fella didn't come to the church where I pastored, but of course, they knew me. And for out of the blue, he said, Brother Embry, I just don't believe you ought to preach politics. And I thought, oh, I wonder who he's been talking to, because the man's never heard me preach, you know. And I said, well, you know, the Bible was political, a lot of it, before it ever become, politics was biblical before they ever become politics. And when we look toward the eschatology, which is just the teaching of the Word of God that leads to end time events, the Antichrist will do, he's going to be very political, isn't he? The Antichrist. He'll be a dictator. He will bring about a world power. He will bring about one world government. He will bring about one world monetary system. He will have one military, and it'll all be political. But see, the devil's political, isn't he? The devil is. And so we're not here today to argue your politics. We're here to worship Jesus Christ and Him crucified. We're here to believe upon Him, the one that died for sin and rose again. And I'm glad of that today. I'm glad that He died for me. We welcome you in the name above all names. We have guests with us today. And if you come more than once, you're no longer a guest. You just become part of us, okay? But we want to recognize you. We have a couple from Georgia that I've met and getting to know. And James, we're glad to have you and your sweet wife with us today. I've got it. And I don't always recognize people by name, but there's a two couples here today. And then we have Craig and Phyllis McNeil. And Craig was a deacon at Belmont for so many years when I was there. And I got the great joy of being their pastor. Amen. Been through a lot of tough times together. And more than tough times, a lot of wonderful times in worshiping God and building the kingdom. And so, I'm so glad that in the family of God on earth, you bond together through so many different ways, just like you do in our earthly families, our physical families. So we welcome all of you, and let's just have church, okay? If I wasn't wanting to preach so much, I would have already been probably shouting and running the aisles. Y'all, you say, Brother Gary, you keep talking about that and you've never done it. Well, I may not ever do it, but I keep talking about it. I'm going to do it one day, aren't we? I'm going to run down the street of gold just like that old boy that Jesus healed, Peter, through the name of Jesus, healed at the gate called Beautiful. He didn't get up and say, well, I think my legs are working. He got up and started running, didn't he? And leaping and praising God. And every once in a while when we're reminded of what he saved us from, we ought to get up and leap and praise God in our own special way. All right, let's give praise to the Bible, and then we're going to preach just a little bit, okay? This is my Bible, the Word of God, inspired, infallible, inerrant, alive, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. Heaven and earth will pass away. God's word will never pass away. I will make it a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. I will hide its word in my heart, that I may not sin against God. Hallelujah. Give him praise in the house of God. I want to read some scripture in your hearing today that a good pastor friend of mine, and more than a friend, we were discussing scripture as we often do about 3 or 4 weeks ago, and this was a scripture that came up, and it's been on my heart ever since, and I knew I had that feeling that God was going to let me preach on it one of these days, and so here we are. It's that day, and we want you to turn in Isaiah chapter 55. Now, he may have already preached it. It's been preached a few times through the years, I guess. You know, it's all been preached. The prophet Isaiah was preaching it, wasn't he, when he wrote it and penned it, and God inspired him to send it to the nation of Judah, God's beautiful, wonderful people, Israel, that was split in, the monarchy was split in 722 BC by the Assyrians and the 10 northern tribes. I've told you this. I want you to get this in your mind so you can understand the word of God. And the 10 northern tribes fell to the Assyrians in 722 BC. The southern kingdom, Judah, that Isaiah is writing to would last about another 100 years, and they would fall to the Babylonians. Aren't we living in a Babylonian culture? Are we not today? I'm telling you, Babylon was destroyed five times by five different nations and kept coming back. And they came back the same every time. They were all about their garments, the outward appearance, about the temporal, about the flesh, about things of this life. And why? Because they didn't know God. They didn't know our God, did they? They didn't know the Hebrew God. And so I see America today living in this Babylonian culture, and I want you to read with me from chapter 55, beginning in verse 6 and following. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the righteous man his thought, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. And let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him. And to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts, verse 8, are not your thoughts. Somebody say amen. Amen. Neither are Neither are your ways my ways. And my glasses are failing me today. My eyes failed some time ago. As far as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts your thoughts. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the house of God at Duval's Chapel, we ask you to come near us, God, as we attempt to preach this message. Our heart is full of the joy of the Lord today, God. We feel your presence, Lord, because where two or three are gathered together in thy name, there at my name, you said, there I am in the midst, and you're with us today, oh God. What a wonderful thing it is to know that the living God is in our presence today. Father, help me to preach this message not for fame nor fortune, but to bring you glory and honor and salvation to lost souls. I pray this in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm not even going to give the message a title today. I had two or three picked out, but they were just mine and not God's. And so I'm just going to preach, okay? I'm going to preach from this scripture that I read to you, but I got some things to say before we get back to the scripture. Now, let me explain to you where we're at in scripture. The great book of Isaiah, many of you have studied it. You know who the prophet was speaking to, which was the southern kingdom and the nation of Judah. Now, he was kind of in the midst of, it was during the days of Hezekiah. He was a mentor, or you could say he was a counselor to the great king Hezekiah. He would live through about four kings. He began his ministry, and God called him in the year that King Uzziah died. You remember that? He said, I saw the Lord high and mighty lifted up. And he looked into the throne room of God, and he saw the seraphims, the six-winged angels, and God was so holy, the angels hid their face from him. And I'm telling you, this is a holy God, isn't it? When even the angels of God hide their face because they're not worthy to look upon him. Boy, how far we have strayed as the church of the living God and as people who claim to be God. But I'll get back to that in just a moment. So Isaiah was called of God to prophesy to a backslidden people, Judah. Now, I listened to a preacher maybe just this week, and he tried to compare that Judah was the church and the church was Judah, and that's nonsense. Judah is was the nation of God, the people of God, the southern kingdom, as I've already pointed out. Now, who were they? They were the apple of God's eye. They were the people that God was going to bring the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords through, the Messiah, the Savior of the world. And God had called them up and had chosen them out of Abraham's loins to be this people. And they were a backslidden, stiff-necked, hard-hearted people because they would get their eyes on the world more than their eyes on God. Does that sound like anybody you know? Now, I want you to get this. Isaiah is speaking to them. They were people, a blessed people. God had made covenants, as we studied Wednesday night here in Bible study. God had made covenants to these. They were his covenant people, you could say. He had made promises to Abraham that would extend on from generation to generation until the end of days, the scriptures teach. These were the people, but the problem was, again, they were always looking at the world instead of looking at God. They were influenced by the things around them. Everywhere they went, everywhere they looked, there were things around them that the devil had placed there, the devil's people, and instead of being influenced by the prophets and these holy men of God, they were being influenced by the world, Now, and you say, Brother Gary, why are you preaching this if he's not talking to the church? The church is straying today. Or let me say this. The people of the earth today are straying much like Judah did in her day. Can anybody deny how blessed we have been as a people to be a citizen of this great country? You cannot deny that. You cannot, anyone, Democrat, Republican, Independent, or whoever, can be brought up in this nation and believe that we are a part of the greatest people, the greatest nation on planet Earth today, and have been the greatest for over 200 years, right? Right. And I want to tell you what's made her great. It's not our natural resources. It's not our politics. It's not our Constitution. Even though I love the Constitution of America, it is not that that has made America great. It is the God that we have chosen to follow who has made America great today. She has been great ever since we have been, was ordained as a godly nation, and she will continue to be great as long as we keep our eyes on the Lord. Amen. You can't deny it, guys. God's had his hand on this thing. Amen. We haven't been perfect. We're not perfect. Neither was Judah perfect. The church is not perfect. But we have a perfect God. We have a perfect God. Now you say, Brother Gary, you're going to preach politics? No, I'm not. But I'm telling you, America is great today because we have a great God. And we were ordained by the founding fathers to be a Judeo-Christian nation. What does that mean? That we believe the Bible, Old and New Testament, rightly divided. Amen. Did you know that in our early schools, the kids learned to read out of the Bible? Did you know that? They learned to read out of the Bible. Why? Because they didn't have all the textbooks that we had to have today. But we got so smart and had the ability to print everything that the world has to offer to educate and to indoctrinate our kids. And so now look where we're at today. God help us. I'm going to preach it if you throw your songbooks at me. I'm going to preach it if you throw your songbooks at me. I'm telling you, we have played the role of the prodigal son in America. We have. Now, I want to get to the church in a minute. We have sinned away the blessings of the Father. It's okay to say amen. That's what Judah did. Judah, in the time of Isaiah and Jeremiah and Daniel and all of these prophets, major and minor prophets, had sinned away the blessings of the Father, the Holy Father. The prodigal son, the Bible says in Luke's gospel, there was a certain man that had two sons. And the younger of the sons came to his father and said, Father, give me the portion of goods that follow to me. And the father divided unto them his living. And not many days hence, the younger son took off and went to a far country. And what did he do? He didn't multiply his substance. He wasted his substance with riotous living. Why? Because he was no longer with the Father. I want to ask you today, have we squandered away our blessings, the blessings of the Father? Have we done that? God help us today. God help us today as a people. God help us. I'm telling you, In Isaiah's prophecy, Isaiah 66, some call it the little Bible, the Bible within the Bible. The Bible has 66 books. Isaiah has 66 chapters. The middle chapter of Isaiah, what would that be? Chapter 33 is the center of the Bible chapter-wise. And it goes on. It tells of sin. It tells of redemption. It tells of the coming Messiah. Isaiah is a little Bible within the Bible. But Isaiah preached to Judah about their morality, their political corruption, their social corruption, and their spiritual corruption. It was all there. It was all there. Why? Because they had turned from the living God unto idols and unto the world. I'll tell you this, there's one the New Testament tells us to look to, and it's not a hotshot evangelist or this pastor or some singing group. It says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the Father on high. He's the one we're to look to as Christians. There's coming a day, I've already said it, this political leader is going to come. Thank God there will be one that will stand in that day, and that's the Church of the Living God. Actually, the Church of the Living God will be raptured out, and this political dictator will take over. He will take over. One world government, one world currency, one world religion, one world military power. He will be Mr. Everything. Look, God is not focused today. When we look, and all of you, how many of you watch CNN this week? How many of you watch MSNBC? How many of you watch Fox News? How many of you watch some news broadcast? More than we read our Bible, more than we studied the Word of God. Well, I just can't get away from it. I want to tell you something. All you're getting out of them are you're being duped is what you're being, because God's focus is not on any of these cable networks. God's focus is not on a politician or a political system or the Democrats or the Republicans or the independents. God's focus is on the Church of the Living God today. On the Church of the Living God. God help me to preach it. I watch the stuff until I just get sick at my stomach almost from what I'm hearing. Folks, we're living in an immoral time today. We're living in a time of trouble. We're living in a time when the preachers of God ought to be reading from Isaiah 55, verse 6. It's time to call upon the Lord while He is still near. While He's still hearing. While He's still hearing us. Did you know there's going to come a day when God won't hear us anymore? The night is coming when no man will work. One day God will shut the door on the Gentile race, on the Church of the Living God. He's going to declare time to be no more for the church and turn back to Israel. So it's time to pray. It's time to pray. We live in a time when unrighteousness rules the land. Proverbs, what is it? 14:34 says, righteousness exalts a nation. Sin is the reproach of any people. Ain't that right? Right? You know what the problem is today, Sammy? Most people don't know what righteousness is. They really don't know what righteousness is. You know why? We haven't taught them. We haven't lived it before them. We've been two generations when mamas quit walking the aisles and praising God, when daddies quit praying and teaching their kids at the supper table, when the school system dropped the ball and kicked God out of the public education system. And look what we've got. Look what we've got. I believe Romans chapter 1, when they didn't like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to reprobate minds to do the things which are not convenient. And sexuality, impurities come to the top when you leave God out of your learning. Amen. God help us. God help us. God help America. God help our churches. I'm going to get to the churches here in a moment. God help us. God's focus is on the church. I want you to get that. We are still on the winning side. We're still the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're still the one that is the light of the world. We're still the salt of the earth. It may not be popular to be a Christian today, but it's right. It may not be politically correct to preach and teach the unadulterated Word of God, but wouldn't you rather be right than politically correct? Amen. Amen. Good preaching, Brother Gary. Thank you. Thank you. The Bible says that when the righteous rule, the people rejoice. But when the evil are in control, the people mourn. Let me throw this at you. I want to stay with it. We've been wearing Babylonian garments too long. Did you know the church? The church never repents. The church never turns to God. The church strays from God as long as everything's going well. God uses persecution to bring us to our knees. What was it Isaiah said? He called them to repentance, didn't he? I'm going to read it again in a minute and preach it. This is the foundation of the message. Huh? I may preach the message next week. You'll have to come back, okay? I'm just trying to lay the foundation of the message. When you got it good, you don't need God, in other words. That's what the country preacher said. When you got it good, you don't need God. When everything is going fine, when you're healthy and wealthy and everything. everything that's fallen into place. Who needs God? Oh, we'll go through the motions. We'll go to Sunday school. We'll go to worship service. But you don't need him once you leave the house of God, because you can do everything for yourself. The lost don't need him, because the church don't seem to love him anymore. There's not enough preaching from most pulpits to bring about conviction if a lost person does show up. You're okay, I'm okay. We have bought into the gospel of Oprah. You know what Oprah taught on national television? Jesus didn't come to die for your sin. He came to teach you how to live. I got news for Oprah and her disciples. God forbid that I should glory in nothing save the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, in which the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Oh, scarcely for a righteous man would one die. Preadventure for a good man, some would even dare to die. But God commended his love to us that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Hallelujah. That's the gospel according to Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Eric Sieber wrote his book, Disturbing Divine Problems, I believe was the name. I read part of the book till my stomach couldn't take it anymore. He wrote, you can get online, order the book. I wouldn't advise it to anyone, especially young Christians. He wrote that the God of the Old Testament and the God of the New Testament is two different gods. I believe the Bible. Amen. Hear, O Israel, there is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. Right? Ain't that what he said in Deuteronomy? Amen. There's one God, not two gods. You say, well, what about Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost? If you can explain the Trinity, you can preach the rest of this message, because you're a lot smarter than I am. But I'm telling you, Jesus wasn't a part of God. He was God. Amen. The Holy Ghost is not a part of God. He is God. Amen. They are three in one. In the beginning, Elohim created the heaven and the earth. And Elohim is a plural God. How can you be plural and still be one? I don't know. Only God can do it. Amen. Only God can do it. Say, so, well, Brother Gary, you know what you're preaching? I sure do. I don't have to understand it all. You know why? I just read it to you. His ways are as far above my ways are the heavens of the earth, and his intellect, his thoughts given in the King James, but his mind, his intellect is far above mine as the heavens are the earth. He's God. Kevin, he's God. Mike, he's God. We ought to shout it from the rooftop. We ain't got time to play politics. We ain't got time to take an R&R and go on furlough. We're in a battle, folks. We're in a battle. And precious souls are weighed in the balances and found wanting. I got a good message for the lost if somebody would show me one. Everybody's saved anymore. You can drink your booze, drink your wine, drink your beer, run around, cheat, do it all, and you're still saved in many churches today. Not according to the Word of God. Not according to the Word of God. Not according to the Word of God. God help us. God help us. We've indoctrinated our kids with things other than the framework of the Bible. We've told them that they're bunnies so long they're starting to act, they begin to act like it decades ago. God help us. About 70 years ago, one of the most damnable doctrines known to man hit the United States of America. They call it evolution, but it's a doctrine straight out of hell. The devil knew what he was doing when Darwin wrote his book, Origin of the Species. The devil knew what he was doing. Who could believe such a thing? That's what they said about Isaiah's report, wasn't it? Isaiah 53, who could believe such as... Actually, it says in the King James, who will believe our report? You know what the original Hebrew says? Who could believe such a story? Who could possibly believe that the Son of God would come into this world? Who would be God? Who never would write a book as far as was on the top 10 best-selling list until the Bible come along, hallelujah, and it's been there every year since. Now listen to me. Who could believe such a story? That a beggar, a pauper, that a man who never did anything that would attribute him with greatness could be the Messiah of Israel and the Savior of the world. Who could believe this? When you look at him, there was no beauty. When you look at him, there was nothing that you would desire from him. Who would believe that, Shannon? Who could believe such a story? That's what some said about Darwinism. Who could believe it? Ha! That all of our lives here in the United States of America up until 1950, we believe that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Y'all still believe that? That's what we believe. That's what we grew up on. In my lost home, with my lost mama and daddy, I believed that. You didn't even have to be a Christian to believe that. Because they'd teach it at school. My teachers early on would have devotion, read the Bible, explain the scriptures to you, and instill in your life, heart, outside of the church house, in the classroom, that God was God. But then come Darwinism, the survival of the fittest. It came into America about the turn of the last century, the 1900s. But 1922, the Scopes monkey trial came about in Dayton, Tennessee. And it opened the door, even though the biology teacher won out. It opened the door to believe this damnable heresy that's in the world today. And I don't know why I'm preaching this, but I'm going to preach it. Amen. It caught on like wildfire. It dominates our science. It dominates our politics. It dominates the medical profession. It dominates our educational system. You can't get by anywhere with teaching anything in public other than evolution. And you know what evolution teaches? There is no God. I mean, if God is not the creator, there is no God. Right? If you have a problem with in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, Genesis 1 verse 1, you're going to have a problem with the rest of the Bible, because how do we know that any of it's true if that's not true? That was 70 years ago. Look at where we're at now. Look at where we are at now. What? We have forsaken God as Judah forsook God. And now get this. It's going to get worse, guys. We got this thing called critical race theory that's indoctrinating our kids today even to a more damnable ways of life than even evolution. I never thought I'd see it, but it's happening. And you better not say anything. No, you better not stand up. Well, I can't stand up, Brother Gary. They'll kick me out of school. They'll take my job. They'll do this. They'll do that. You know what they did to Isaiah? You know what they did to Jeremiah? They stood up, didn't they? They stood up. Jeremiah stood up. You know what they did to him? They put him in a cistern, in a sewer, up to his neck. Somebody came, you can read the Bible, somebody came and got him out. They stoned him. They killed him. They despised him. They hated him. But they stood up for what was right. Amen. Loudoun County, Virginia. You can say this is politics if you want to. I'm telling you, it is immoral. We live in a sewer today in America. Amen. Little girl went to school. Had one of these restrooms where the gay people, the transgender, could come in. Yeah. There was a boy came in there wearing a dress and raped that little girl. You see the news? Well, what'd they do? The school board superintendent denied it. The father came and stood up for you. What would you do? Let me ask you, what would you do if it was your grandbaby or your grand or your daughter? Guess what? They arrested the father. You can't make this stuff up. They arrested the father. And then they apologized. Said, well, I didn't understand it. I don't know what all they did say. It didn't matter. This is where we're at. This is where we're at. Why are we here? Why are we here? Sin. Turning from the living God. Just like Lot's wife, as we studied today. She couldn't keep from looking back. And looking at the world and the things that she was leaving behind. And it's not just politics, guys. It's right in the churches. Amen. Right in the churches. God's not looking at your denomination. He could care less whether you're a Presbyterian or a Baptist. He could care less whether you're a Methodist or a Pentecostal. He's looking at your heart. He looks at our heart, and the only thing that can cleanse our heart is the truth of God's Word and the Holy Spirit manifesting itself. The blood of Jesus washes away our sin. I love that scripture. Oh, if you walk in the light as He is in the light, you have fellowship one with another. Are you in fellowship with God today? And the blood of Jesus, His Son, cleanses you from all of it. It's a 24/7 process, guys. It didn't just happen one night in a revival meeting somewhere. God sticks with you. And you are to stick with God. God, help me to preach it. God, help me to preach it. Churches. Churches. The bride of Christ. Isn't that precious? The bride of Christ. It's wonderful. Well, Brother Gary, how can we be the bride of Christ? Because God said we are. That's good enough for me, ain't it you? And I'm going to go to the marriage supper of the Lamb one day. Well, Brother Gary, how long will that be? It'll be 7 years, according to Bible prophecy. 7 years. Well, how do you know that? You just come to Wednesday night study and I'll explain a lot of this. I don't have time today. But I want to tell you one thing. While I'm at the marriage supper, and it ain't going to cost me a dime. My baby girl cost me a fortune to get her away from home. I mean, I don't even want to know how much it was. I said, Carolyn, just don't tell me how much it is. I don't want to know. Maybe the best money ever spent. I don't know. But this ain't going to cost me a dime. Elaine, it hasn't cost me a dime to be a part of this bride. Not a dime. Why? Because on a hill far away. Stood at an old rugged cross. Hallelujah. For He hath made Him to be sin. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For He hath made Him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. So if He died to make us righteous, what manner of person ought we to be, huh? But we have been duped. The gospel has been dumbed down. Grace has been made cheap. Not through the Holy Spirit, not through the Word of God, but by postmodern teaching. If you believe that you can live like hell and go to heaven, you got another belief. You need to change your belief system. Because therefore, if any man be in Christ Jesus, he is a new creature. Old things pass away, and behold, all things become new. Right? Amen. Well, Brother Gary, are you righteous, more righteous? I'm not as righteous as anybody else. Except for the grace of God, there I am. Amen. Well, Brother Gary, you don't know my history. No, you don't know his story. It doesn't matter what your history is if you'll believe His story. Because He'll save you. He'll cleanse you. He'll cast your sins as far away. He'll separate your sins as far as the east is from the west. He knew right then the globe was round and not flat, right? Why don't some of these hotshot scientists start looking at the Bible and get a little smarter? You know, Harvey invented or discovered, I should say, the circulatory system, didn't he? And when he looked at, he said, whoa, look here. The life of the flesh is in the blood. It's the blood that carries and everything you need to the cells, and the blood that carries everything you don't need away from the cells. All they had to do is look at Leviticus 14 and 17, isn't it? For the life of the flesh is in the blood. I'm telling you, we're so smart, we become dumb, don't we? I'm going to try to land this plane, all right? I've been circling the airport. Look at verse 6. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. It's time, guys. You know somebody that once came to this church, once sang in this choir, once prayed at this altar, once sat in the Sunday school or taught Sunday school, that's out there no longer walking in the light as he is in the light? It is our duty, your duty, to warn them. Amen. To call upon the Lord while he is near. And he is. Now you may think he's so far away, America's in this bad shape, and churches are changing, and these new churches springing up and believing everything and anything, that he's so far away that he don't even care. Let me tell you, God cares. God is still calling those to repent that have strayed from him, to repent. What does repent mean? It means to turn around. Turn around. That's what Judah had to do. Turn around. There's an old song that we used to sing. Turn around, turn around. He's saying, Judah, repent. You know what John the Baptist, first thing out of his mouth? Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. You know what Jesus preached? He preached it in the Sermon on the Mount. Except you repent, you perish. Maybe that wasn't a Sermon on the Mount. Maybe that was, do you suppose that the 18 that Pilate mangled in their blood to a sacrifice was the worst among sinners? Nay, but I tell you, except you repent, you'll also perish. You know what Pilate did? Pilate killed 18 men, took their blood and mingled it with the sacrifices and put it on the altar of God. That's pretty corrupt, isn't it? Huh? Were they the worst? No. Isaiah is calling Judah to repent. Call upon him while he's near. Let the backslider forsake his ways. That's repentance, isn't it, guys? Our churches need to get back. Not just individually, but collectively as the church. Needs to get back to believing this, that right here. One thing, this right here. One thing. Say, well, Brother Gary, I disagree with you on something. Boy, I hope so. I hope that we don't have any robots in this, no puppets that I pull you string. Look, but if you'll just believe the Bible, you won't be very far apart. There'll be some things we won't see eye to eye, but we're not going to debate those. We're just going to believe the Bible. I'd be a fool to think that I preach like I preach and everybody, amen, Brother Gary, I believe everything you're saying, or teach on one. No, but I'm going to be faithful to my calling. And you be faithful to yours. But let's build this church. Let's build Duval's Chapel. I got some things I'm going to present to the council next Sunday. We need to get back in business, don't we? We need a big sign out here in the parking lot, open for business. Too many businesses are shutting down, right? And the churches along with them. Back in business. Well, I'm just afraid of the COVID. You ain't afraid to go to Walmart. Ain't afraid to go to the UK games, or you'll be at the ballparks this fall, basketball arenas. Let's have church. Let's have church. We could backslide because of COVID and not even know it. Until we've gone so far, it's hard to get back. Let's stand together. Let's stand together. Come on, Hannah. Oh, there's so much more on here. If you can preach a message off of that, you're a whole lot better preacher than I am. Look, here's where we're at. If you're in this building today and you've never been saved, what does that mean, Brother Gary? You've never got on your knees before God with a broken heart and a contrite spirit. In other words, under conviction. You've never seen, you saw your sin, but you never called on the Lord for forgiveness. See, that's what conviction does. It shows you who you really are, a sinner without the grace of God. So if that's the case, walk this aisle this morning. I promise you, on the authority of God's word, if you call upon Him in faith, believing, God will save you as you have been drawn to Him. Now, you're here today, and you backslid. You say, well, Brother Gary, where's the line on back? I don't know. This is a relationship between you and God. And if there's something in that relationship that don't need to be there, bring it to Jesus. If you'll confess your sin, He's faithful and just to forgive you. As we sing together.
Be forever.
stand here and soak it in, don't you? You just kind of want to soak it in. Ephesians 2 and 8 tells us that we are saved by grace through faith and that not of ourselves. And Titus chapter 2 says, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation, get this now, hath appeared unto all men. My Calvinist friends have got it wrong. All men, anybody, anyone can be saved by God's unmerited favor. Somebody want to praise him right now.